Is entitled With My Whole Heart. Again, Psalms chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. Please read aloud with me. The words are behind me on the overhead or follow along in your Bibles. Once again, we're in Psalms chapter number 9, verses 1 through 5. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in thee. I will sing praise to thy name, O thou most high. When mine enemies are turned back, they shall fall and perish at thy presence. For thou hast maintained my right and my cause. Thou sattest in the throne judging right. Thou hast rebuked the heathen. Thou hast destroyed the wicked. Thou hast put out their name forever and ever.
Bibles, hot dogs, and homemade ice cream contest. I like that. I like Bibles being first. Hot dogs, well, that's not my favorite, but you know what? That's okay. That's good. And homemade ice cream. I'm coming for homemade ice cream. And if you've never made homemade ice cream before, I tell you what, we're going to have some fun yet today. And I'm going to try to make some new homemade ice cream in a way I have never made it before. You'll want to invite someone to come and be with us. We begin our service, and we have a color guard from Luke Air Force Base. And we remember our country on the 4th of July. It's Independence Day. We remember our veterans and those that are serving in our country. We're thankful for them today. And let me tell you something else. Our former music director, Ted Phillips, some of you would remember Ted, has a great voice. Pastor Adrian and I were in Springfield. We got a chance to talk with he and Trinda, and they are going to be back with us, and he is our special guest soloist next coming Sunday. You don't want to miss it. So if you know him and love him, you'll want to be here. If you don't know him, then you're going to enjoy his voice. He was here. He has a beautiful voice. He's going to sing for us this coming Sunday on the 4th of July. We're going to have a great time next Sunday. Now, let me share with you, last week, our Supreme Court sent out a ruling that's going to affect you. It's going to affect your family. It's going to affect our church. Maybe not this moment, but it will. And next week, as we celebrate Independence Day, we're going to look at the Supreme Court. We're going to kind of see it today through David's eyes, and I believe God's given us this passage. I had this planned long before that Supreme Court decision came out, and I think you'll see where our eyes need to be focused. But next week, we're going to look at very practical ways of living in America in a different culture. And you're going to have to answer some personal questions. I began just to think about it. Is the gay lifestyle a sin? You're going to have to answer that. You can't remain silent on that anymore. You're going to have an answer for that. How about this? This is going to get real personal. Should I go to my gay friends or gay family members' wedding? You're going to have to answer that personal question. Maybe not tomorrow, but I believe in our culture, it will be a question you will have to answer. 20 years ago, you didn't think you have to have that answer, but you're going to have to answer. We're going to look at the scriptures and try to biblically decide to have answers to our culture and then how we're to share the gospel to our culture, because that is focus. So be here next Sunday. I believe the message is relevant and important to us. Now, the Psalm chapter number 9. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I hope you're beginning to understand this. This is interactive. These songs that we sing when we come to church, as we open up God's Word, this is interactive. He begins by saying, I will. This is something that is part of who He is and what He wants to do. And it's praise filled with gratitude and thanksgiving. And we sang that this morning. Great is thy faithfulness. That's the way we sang it, and it goes right along with this. However, as we begin to read not only the first five verses, but on through, let me just share with you, chapters number 9 and 10 go together. In the Hebrew language, chapters 9 and 10 are in a system that begins each section with a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And that is done sometimes throughout Psalm, and it is done here. So 9 and 10 go together. And the purpose here, we're going to see, is to encourage David's heart. David didn't get up this morning, didn't come to church with a smile on his face. You know, David had some really bad things happen to him in the recent past. David, we're going to find out, woke up on Sunday morning and he didn't feel like coming to church. He didn't feel like worshiping and singing. David didn't have a great morning and could have found 100 different ways not to sing this song. So he is singing a praise because he needs some hope. His heart needs some encouragement, and he's going to sing this song. He says, praise thee, O Lord. And remember, we talked about that word Lord, that's Yahweh. That is the Creator, the God of all things. This is beyond our comprehension when we use this word Lord. Praise you, thank you. And he's going to give us two reasons. He's giving honor that is due to this Creator of all things. Praise you. It's due you. And then, because I praise you, great is thy faithfulness, it gives hope to my heart. It gives me something to look forward to tomorrow morning, to get up. Some people can't wake up tomorrow morning because there is no hope. And suicide is rampant in our society. There is no hope. But David sings this song. Praise, David says, for the past, because it leads me to trust and hope in the future. The future. my children, my grandchildren, America, Thomas Road Baptist Church. I have hope for the future because I look back and praise Jesus Christ. Let's look at it in verse number 1. He's going to say something that's very decisive, very emphatic. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. Boy, that's the way we ought to sing. Not halfway, not paying attention, but with my whole heart. If we're going to get something out of it, if it's not going to be just, we watch TV so passively. We do so many things today. We've got a phone, we've got the computer on, we've got the radio in the background, we've got the TV, and someone calls you on the phone, you're talking to them on the phone, but you're doing everything else, right? Your wife goes, and you go, yes, honey. You go, well, I didn't hear you say anything. Well, you didn't hear your wife either. Wives, just as true. Your husband says something, and you have to go, huh? I do. You know, sometimes you have an earplug in your ear. Okay, am I preaching to myself, Julie? All right. Okay, I like to listen to audiobooks. So I got an audiobook, and I'm listening to a book, and Julie walks into the room, and she says something to me. I wasn't ready. I would have paid attention to her. I was listening to my book, and I turn it off, and I say, yes. And she goes, you never listen to me. And she storms out. Don't look so quiet, some of you, because you know it may not be the same way in your house, but it's pretty close. Yeah, it gets close. It gets real close here, doesn't it? We do things passively. So, why am I stopping here? Is because when we come to worship God, He gets our full and focused attention with my whole heart. Why? David is only giving us, he's echoing a command, going back to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 6, verse 5 says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. That's with everything. Well, I know we get busy during the week, but when it comes time for church, when we're reading our scriptures, turn everything off. I mean, we probably say silence your phone somewhere, or we ask you to, but coming to church, that, you know what? Maybe we ought to say leave your phones at home, because this is with my whole heart. Nothing else matters when it comes to this, with my whole heart. David says, if I'm going to get through what I need to get through in my life, if I'm going to praise you, if I'm going to have outrageous joy, I better be decisive. I'd better do this with my whole heart, with determination. Let me tell you this morning, with determination, praise the Lord. When you listen to the message, Pastor Adrian's teaching at 10 o'clock, it's with my whole heart. Otherwise, we'll get up and we'll have missed what God had for us. We'll get up and be negative. I didn't get anything today. Well, you know what? Because we didn't have our whole heart. Deuteronomy 6, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. Boy, that's the very beginning and basic of it. It's praise with determination. There's two words I want to stop and look at this morning. That word praise, that's an important word here. And then he says, show forth thy marvelous works. Let's look at those two words. We don't go back and talk a lot about the Hebrew. But in Psalm, as we look at what they were singing about, we almost have to so we can understand sometimes what's going on here. Here, when he uses this word praise, and there are different words that are translated praise for us. Here, the Greek, or the Hebrew word is yada. It means to acknowledge or to confess. Psalm chapter number 32, verse 5 says it. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquities have I not hid. David says, I acknowledge. It's the same word that it says praise. David here is acknowledging. He's recognizing. He's professing the Lord's actions in his life when he says, I praise you. I'm looking back and I'm acknowledging all that you have done for me. He sees the Lord's hand on his life and he goes, God, I got to worship you. I'm so glad it was you and not me. Have you ever, that was when I was going to sing, but Pastor Joel, I'm not going to sing now. Have you ever looked back and gone, boy, I didn't know the right answers, didn't even know that that was going to work out like that, had no clue, and now you look back and go, boy, God's hand was in the middle of all that. In 2003, and as I moved out here to Phoenix, I was going to be a principal of a new school and be a part of this new school, and after 2 years, I resigned. And I'd been at one place my whole adult life. I'd been at one church my whole adult life. God, why'd you bring me out to the desert? And I knew I was supposed to resign. I didn't have to, but knew it was the right thing for me to do. And a couple weeks later, I get a phone call from Ted Phillips. He's going to be here. He used to be the music director here. And their son was part of our Christian school, and Ted and Trenda says, come on and have wings at our house. We want to go have wings. And let's do it Friday. Oh, I can't do it Friday. We had other things already scheduled. It was maybe that night. Come and have, let's get together tonight. Can't do it tonight. And so I said, tell you what, Julie, we'll go to church with them on Sunday. And Julie, being the wise, prepared person, will call them back to make sure they're going to be there. He's the song director. He's the worship leader. He's going to be there. He has to be there. Well, I got to church, you know what? He wasn't there. Why'd he invite me out to get wings? He was going to tell me he had taken a church over in California. But he didn't tell me that, so I came to church. And then I found out Pastor Adrian had resigned. And I had resigned, Pastor Adrian resigned. We didn't really know each other very well. And I don't know. He goes, why don't you have coffee with me on Monday morning? I said, sure, that sounds good. And so I met with him Monday morning. And we get up early and Tuesday morning met with him. And you know, two homeless, jobless people needed to, you know, we needed to share our what we're going to do. And we did, and Wednesday we did it again. And Thursday we hadn't finished. And Friday, he goes, why don't you come back to church on Sunday? So I said, okay. So I came back to church on Sunday. And then a little bit longer, he goes, why don't you, he says, church wants me to stay a little bit longer. We go into that story a little bit. And he goes, I'm going to stay for a little bit longer. Will you just help me for a little bit? And I said, sure, I'll help you for a little bit. And then that was in about August. That takes us to about, of 2005, that takes us to about February, and people are looking for positions and education and principals and things like that. And he says, oh, don't start looking for a job now. I know I'm still busy. He says, was that your words? Don't do that. Don't do that. You don't want to do that. Yeah. And so, and here we are today. We're still serving the Lord. We could have coffee tomorrow morning. It wouldn't matter. You know what? We're still together serving the Lord. I had no idea when I came to church 10 years ago. I came just to see Ted and Trenda, thought we'd go out to lunch afterwards and see, you know, how they were doing. I had no idea what God was doing. And that's what David is saying. Boy, I acknowledge, man, I look back and I have to worship you because your hand is in all of this. I would have never done this. If you'd have said, you're moving from Indiana and you're going to go out there and you're going to be part of Thomas Road Baptist Church, I'd have gone, no, I don't think so. That's not my plan. That was in God's plan. David says, I acknowledge it. There's a second word, show forth. It's sopar. It has a numbering idea to it. In Genesis chapter number 15, the word is used. When God told Abraham, go outside and begin to count the stars. Number the stars, and that's how many children and grandchildren and offspring you're going to have. And so that same word is here when it says show forth. It's number the stars. Go out and begin to number the ways God has been gracious and kind to you. Show forth. Begin to count. Why? Well, that was a big story you told about coming to Thomas Road Baptist Church. That's one thing. That's good. But what about last week? Can I begin to count? Sure, I can count last week. We had a great service last Sunday morning, Father's Day. And Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, my sister-in-law Patty's here. Glad you're here with us, Patty. And my niece came into town, and we took off, and we went and spent a couple days together. We spent Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and relaxed and had a good time. You know what? I can count this last week, how God has been good and gracious to me. That's what David begins with. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth, or I'm going to count all thy marvelous works. Boy, and it begins to number. He's intentional. He's looking beyond himself. And who's he focusing on? Jesus. He is not focusing on the circumstances of his life. We haven't begun to look at where he is in his life, but he's not thinking about that. He's not focused on anything other than God's gracious act. Let me just say, as you think about last week and decisions of our country, and maybe they weren't the way you thought they should be, or the politicians haven't done what you think they should have done, from Congress to the President to the Supreme Court, David says, get your focus off of all of those things and on God's gracious acts and begin to count them. And then he goes on in verse number 3-8 and tell us where he's really at. Appears like his enemies are having a good time at his expense. He should be king. Things should be okay with him, but they're not. Boy, think every being king, life would be easy, but it's not that way. There are wicked people in his life that are trying to hurt him. In chapter number 10, I told you these two chapters go together. He begins to name these in clear ways. He says these are boastful, these are arrogant people in verse number 2 of chapter 10. They're boastful in verse number 3. They're godless in chapter number 4. He says in verse number 5, these bad people are even prosperous. He says they're overconfident. And verse number 7, he gets real personal. If you're there, let's look at verse number 7. Psalm chapter number 10, verse 7. His mouth is full of cursings and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. This is getting personal. He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places doth he murder the innocent. His eyes are privily set against the poor. He lieth in wait secretly, as a lion in his den. He lieth in wait to catch the poor. He doth catch the poor. When he draweth him into his net, he croucheth and humbleth himself, that the poor may fall by his strong ones. Verse number 11. He has said in his heart, God hath forgotten. He has hidden his face. He will never see it. God doesn't see what I do. We can do anything we want to do. That's what David's foes were doing. Yeah. It's outrageous acts of the wicked. And there's no immediate justice. And it looks like they're never going to get justice from this. However, in chapters numbers 9, verses 3-8, David doesn't look at that here. He's looking forward. Remember, he's singing. He's focusing on God. So he is anticipating coming judgment. Maybe God's not judging today, but God will judge because he knows something about a holy and true God. Verse number 3 of chapter number 9. I'm just going to paraphrase him for us this morning as we go through it. He says, God will personally rescue me. God's going to personally rescue David, and his presence will be at the decisive moment. When all looks hopeless in the movie, and then everything changes and isn't saved, God does that. Verse number 4, he will bring the ultimate true justice. Verse number 4 says, I trust you, God. It may not happen today, but you're bringing the true judgment ultimately. Here, this, it's a verb form. And David is saying God's judgment has already happened. It's just waiting to be enforced. He's already been caught. God already saw them, what they did. He just hasn't enforced his judgment yet. But he will. Yes, he will. In verse numbers 5 and 6, God has at times destroyed entire nations, and they were wiped off the face of this earth for doing wicked things. And we don't even know their names anymore. He said, we don't even remember the names of these nations any longer because of the way they lived. And David anticipates this being done to his enemies. His enemies, that's what's going to happen. Verse number 7, he says, despite all this chaos and evil in the earth, God sits on the throne and has reign eternally. From eternity past to eternity future, there is one king. It's not a prime minister. It's not a president. It's not a legislature. It's not a supreme court. There is one king, and he reigns supreme. In verse number 8, from his throne, God will bring judgment based upon, number 1, he says, true justice, righteousness, and uprightness. That is what God is going to do. There is a standard that is fair, that in a sinful world we don't understand, but God has a standard, and he will do things fair. And in the midst of all of this very personal pain, David turns to praise. He acknowledges all that in the past that God has done and made his life where he is today. He could have never done it. Think about him. Samuel went to all the other brothers to be king and then said, well, go get the last one out of the shepherd field. You really want to do that? Do we really need to get David? Let's just go back through all of us and because you must have missed it somewhere, Samuel, because it can't be David. And they bring David. And it was David. David killed Goliath. David did these things. He couldn't do that. His confidence is in what God has done in the past and gives him hope because there is future deliverance by faith. Oh, I've got faith in God. Just as Goliath died. Tell you what, if we were studying later on, I remember one of Goliath's brothers, his name is Ishbibenob. I don't know which is worse, Goliath or Ishbibenob, but I've never heard anybody named either, so. He killed Ishbibenob. Well, he didn't. Do you know what? He's fighting with Ishbibenob, and he's tired, and one of his generals comes and saves him and kills him. He says, God, boy, a day I couldn't win the battle my own. God just sent one of my generals to come and be standing next to me and help me out. Boy, God's going to make things right. So he says, I'm going to change my attitude. I'm going to praise God. Boy, I could have an attitude that's angry. I'm the king. I could have an attitude of entitlement, but he changes his attitude. God will and has already made things right, and David knows this, and so should we. He begins by saying, I will. I'm going to change my attitude. I know there are lots of motivational speakers that talk about I will and have all these statements and things like that. I'm not saying that they're all wrong. They're good statements, no doubt. But they're not the statement. Because David gives us the statement. I will praise thee. I'm going to acknowledge thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. And I will show forth all thy marvelous works. And it changes my attitude and changes everything. He begins to wrap this all up, not only with I will, but the Lord will. The Lord will. He communicates his hope in God. And he uses a metaphor here of a fortress where God's people can run. So there is a place where you can run and God will be there and protect you. Verse number 9, the Lord will be a refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in time of trouble. And they that know thy name will put their trust in thee, for thou, O Lord, hath not forsaken them that seek thee. There is a citadel of strength based upon the promises in God's word. You see, God is who he is, and he says, I will protect you. David's confidence is in him, and God will do it not tomorrow, but when I need it now. And he invites those who would read this psalm, Psalm 9, to worship God because God is just. God is just. There are a lot today that talk about, in generations past, doing good. Today we call it social justice. And there's nothing wrong with doing good. There's nothing wrong with trying to give some social justice. You know, last summer we worked really hard and we made bags and we handed them out to the homeless and we gave them a God. There's nothing wrong with that. But where is our focus? It's not in the doing good. It's in the God who is our refuge. It's in the track. It's in Jesus Christ. He's mindful of them. And he doesn't forget those who are in destruction or in a bad place, David says. Verse number 12, sing praises to the Lord, which dwell in Zion, declare among his people his doings. When he maketh the inquisition for blood, he remembereth them. He forgetteth not the cry of the humble. Man, with all your heart, David says, God's not going to forget me. David runs to this person who he trusts in. David's personal care, his belief, his deliverance, true judgment in this earth is all wrapped up in God. If David says, if this doesn't work out, I have no plan B. This is my only plan, and it is in God. Think about that a little bit. Can you hear the gospel in what he's saying? David's enemies in Psalms, well, we don't know their names and they're not all real clear to us. We know what they're doing. But the New Testament makes it very clear. Man's greatest enemy is sin. We were born sinners. Trouble comes in our lives not from the outside circumstance, but because we are sinners. We have sin in our lives. Sin in us, it's all around us. And it is a problem. We can point our fingers at different other ones, but it's in us. And the Bible says in the New Testament, we are under the curse of sin. Why do bad things happen? We're under the curse of sin. But Jesus, who comes and orders to provide an atonement, he is going to change everything in the New Testament. He dies on the cross. So that those trusting in his work and in his name, Jesus Christ, to be their Savior, to forgive them of their sins, he makes everything new. That's what salvation is all about. That's the gospel. How about Romans chapter number 9 or 10, verses 9 and through verse 13, makes this very clear this morning. We go through life and we try to be a good Christian. That doesn't do it. Here's the difference. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, then that thou shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between Jew and Greek. There's no difference. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call on him. Who can call on the Lord Jesus Christ? All. It doesn't matter. Here he says Jew and Greek. We could say, as we sang the song, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. You remember singing that song? I did when I was a child. It doesn't matter what color you are. It doesn't matter what you've done in the past. It doesn't matter when you come to Jesus Christ. Verse number 13 says it so clearly. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's the deciding factor. Now, it's not those who want to live in their life in sin and add a little religion. That doesn't work. Jesus says, call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Jesus becomes our ultimate fortress when we trust in Him. He is our stronghold. We flee to Him for relief because it's He who we trust. It's like the hymn writer Hewitt wrote in 1891, "My faith has found a resting place, not in device or creed. I trust the ever-living One, His wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. Enough for me that Jesus saves, the end my fears and doubts. A sinful soul, I come to Him, He'll never cast me out." You know this song? I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. That's what David is talking about, his fortress. Jesus did it all. That's the good news. Your past, man, it's sometimes hard to get over, but it's the past. It's Jesus Christ. David says in Psalm 9, verse 9, "The Lord will be my refuge, or will be the refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in time of trouble. And they that know thy name have put your trust in Jesus Christ." Romans 10, 13. Doesn't matter who you are. "Put their trust in thee, for thou, O Lord, hath not forsaken them that seek thee." Boy, that's the message. I begin acknowledging and praising you. Man, I know all the bad things that's happening that I wish it wouldn't, that all the bad people in this world, David says, but boy, I trust in you, and you will not forsake me. David doesn't say my life's going to be easy, or that it's going to be get better, and I'll be this king, and life will, and I'll live happily ever after. He doesn't say that. No, he kind of ends it in a flourish. In verses 19 and 20, God will be seen for who He is in the end, and man will be shown for who he really is. In the end, God will be shown for who He is, and man will be shown for who he really is. Maybe David's saying, "God, just get them. God, get them." Psalm 9, verses 19 and 20. "Arise, O Lord, let not man prevail. Let the heathen be judged in thy sight. Put them in fear, O Lord, that the nations may know themselves to be but men." Selah. Think on that. David's not commanding God to do something. He's preaching out of his own heart that God is God and He will be victorious and man will be shown for who he really is. Let me give you three important lessons this morning and bring it all to us important. Number one, gratitude brings grace. This praise, this acknowledging of who God is and all He has done for us. He says, "I praise you." It's not just an important and appropriate reaction for God doing something for you. No, it's more than that. It's, "God, I praise you." It's gratitude. "You have been in control and helped me my whole entire life. Man, I've been recounting the wonderful deeds that you've done. And it's like oxygen to me that's drowning in all this around me. It's giving me life. It gives me grace." Let me tell you, gratitude to God reminds us about things we're too quick to forget. God is worthy of our trust. I don't know where you are today. God is worthy of your trust. And if you need proof, David says, diligently look back in your past and see how God has done great things. If God has not done those things, you might need to call on His name. Here's the second thing I want you to see. I have another poem here. It's a song you know. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed. Some of you may remember this song. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. We sing that song, don't we? Count your blessings. Number two, we need to seek God. More than keep your chin up, I wrote, keep your eyes, keep your focus, keep your head up. Keep it focused on Jesus. We need to see Jesus in prayer, in our private worship, not focused on all this around us. We keep our eyes focused when we pray personally, when we come in corporate worship. The Lord lifts us up through His Word. That's what I need. I keep my eyes up, my head up, not just my chin up. Number three, choose to make pain a platform for praise. Choose to make pain a platform for praise. This morning, last week, had a difficult week. Things didn't work out the way you wanted. You've got a thorn, a neighbor, a person at work that's just a problem, and it won't go away, you don't think. David says, choose to make pain a platform for praise. You say this morning, I will not allow painful circumstances. I will not allow destructive people. I will not allow personal hardships in my life to define and take over my life. I'm going to say that again because I think we all need that in our, and David is sending this message so strongly to us. I will not allow, by God's grace, painful circumstances, destructive people, personal hardships to define me, and I will not let them take over my life by God's grace. I am going to sing. I will praise Thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all Thy marvelous works. By looking back, David sees both the present and the future differently. By looking up, he gains a perspective that he didn't have on the pain in his life. And he can say, I choose to live differently. At 9 o'clock, I don't choose to live average. I choose to live, that word in Philippians was, with excellence, above average, because of Jesus Christ. I will praise Thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all Thy marvelous works. Let's bow our heads this morning. This morning, maybe you say, Pastor, I've come to church a long time. I've tried to do some of this stuff and the rest. I get caught up in chasing after rabbits of what society's doing, and that's what I want to talk about. I think it's because I've never trusted Christ as my Savior. Pastor says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I've done good things. I've never trusted Christ as my Savior. This morning, say, Pastor, will you pray for me? And I will do that for you this morning. Would you lift your hand this morning? I have never trusted Christ as my personal Savior. I hope that's true. No one's raised their hand. And so I take that we all this morning know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. And what a message David gives us. What a song that we're to sing, to be interactive. I will praise Thee with my whole heart. Let me say, Pastor, will you pray for me this morning? I've got some destructive people in my life, and I need to change my attitude. I need to look at things a little bit differently. There are some painful circumstances in my life, and I'm getting my eyes on those too often. There's some personal hardship There's some physical difficulties in my life, and that's what I want to talk about all the time. Pastor, will you pray for me that I may sing this song that David has? Would you raise your hand this morning? Say, Pastor, just pray for me this morning. I appreciate that. I appreciate that all over. Some painful circumstance, some destructive people, some personal hardships. I'm going to pray for you that they will not define you and they will not take over your life. Our dear Heavenly Father, some have raised their hand this morning. They're in a difficult place like David was, but they're not going to be defined by it. They are going to learn to sing the song of Jesus. They are going to learn to run to the fortress of Jesus Christ and by faith trust Him, that He is the King and the ultimate judge, and everyone will stand before this judge and truly be judged, and His judgments are righteous and His judgments are clear. Lord, may that be our song. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning. Don't know what God lays on your heart. Maybe you want to come and pray. I'll pray with you this morning. Maybe there's something that you need an encouragement just with prayer. I'd be glad to do that this morning. Maybe this morning you say, I need to take another step of faith. I need to be saved. I know I didn't raise my hand. I need to be saved. I need to be baptized. I need to be a member of Thomas Road Baptist Church. I need to take another step in my faith. Pastor Joe, will you lead us?
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily.